I would like first starting by thanking all the people who have been participating to the panel today, and to acknowledge the quality of the discussion and the challenges that have been raised and that we are going to be confronted. I think I'm going to repeat a number of issues that were discussed during the day, but I think they are important. 10 years ago, MSF and Médecins Sans Frontières and the Drugs for Neglect Disease Working Group issued a report called Fatal Imbalance. It pointed out how little research and development focus on neglect diseases. We did this because our patients were dying, often from lack of treatment, and sometimes because of the treatments themselves. R&D was simply abandoned. 10 years on, we have seen some advances, many of them thanks to people in this room, as was shown this morning, highlighted in Jean-Hervé's presentation. But I think we can all agree that progresses have been frustratingly slow, fragmented, and fragile. Right now, our patients are still enduring unnecessarily painful tests and cumbersome and painful treatments. Patients like Zafar, a 12-year-old boy with drug-resistant TB in our MSF program in Tajikistan. Both Zafar's brother and mother died of TB. Zafar has been treated for TB before, but the treatment was unsuccessful. So 3 months ago, he was readmitted to hospital with fever, dry cough, and having lost a lot of weight. He was able to produce enough sputum for analysis and therefore was diagnosed with multi-drug resistant TB. When asked about his treatment, people is becoming very animated and he's counting the pills in his daily dose on his fingers. 3 white pills, 2 yellow pills, 1 red pills, 2 brown capsules, 1 sachet with granules and 1 injection. This will be his life for 2 years. And at the end of that time, he will stand the 50 chance of survival. The only way we will see improvement for patients like Zafar is through the innovative work that was represented in this room today, and through our coming together in a coherent way to make sure the most neglected patients and disease are prioritized. But that's why we are disappointed. We were disappointed 2 weeks ago when a new R&D framework discussed by WHO member states did not go as far as we hoped. Over the past decade, we have seen new and innovative partnerships produce better treatments to fight sleeping sickness, malaria, and other diseases. This is true, but we know that much of this progress has been achieved in the absence of political leadership at the international level to confront diseases that claim millions of lives every year. I know that none of us can accept an international order that allows millions of patients to be left behind by science. We don't want to find ourselves in the same situation in another 10 years. But until we have a sustainable global framework for R&D, we will be forced to use inefficient health tools and continue running programs as best as we can. When it comes to the RTB, patients must go through unimaginable hardship or 50-50 chance of surviving. For Chagas disease, we have to use drugs that were not even developed with Chagas in mind and that can give people adverse reactions. And there is still no test to let patients know if they have been cured. When it comes to vaccinations, the main problem is that epidemics are happening in the first place. If EPI was working, we wouldn't have to conduct mass vaccination campaigns to begin with. But because EPI is not working, we do. And we are conducting this campaign with tools that are simply not adapted to the conditions where most children live. They live in regions in Africa where temperatures can reach more than 110 degrees. Vaccines need refrigerators, so keeping millions of vaccine doses at the right temperature requires a logistical and human resource capacity that defies imagination. It doesn't require that kind of imagination to give kids a vaccine in wealthy countries. Why should we go to these lengths just because the kids we deal with live in the world's poorest region? So we continue to mount massive logistical campaigns to vaccinate millions of children, mostly in Africa every year. We continue to convince patients in Uzbekistan and Kenya that their TB drugs are better than no drugs at all. We continue to run counseling programs in Bolivia and Paraguay to encourage people to stay on Chagas treatments that can produce debilitating side effects. In too many areas, adapting programs to the shortcomings of medical tools is still the only way health professionals can provide medical care at all. I think it's obvious why doctors are so frustrated. On my very first field assignment back in 1988, I was confronted with an unknown disease that was killing hundreds of people in camps for people that was fleeing the war in South Sudan. The lab tests had to be sent out of the country, and it took weeks before we learned that our patients were suffering from Kala-Azar. The treatment at the time was the antimonial SSG, requiring 28 days of toxic and painful intramuscular injection that could kill the patients. Throughout the 90s, the same story was repeated across MSF field programs for other life-threatening diseases, including human African trypanosomiasis or sleeping sickness. For this disease, our patients came to our hospital knowing that the treatment could kill them. Our doctors had nothing better to offer them than injection of femalosoprol, a painful arsenic-based drug, otherwise known as fire in the veins, which killed 1 in 20 patients. I know I started off by saying how frustrated we are at the lack of medical tools at our disposal. But our experience with sleeping sickness and malaria and today's presentations have made it clear that research into neglected disease has certainly improved. Even without game changers like new chemical entities, patients have benefited from this new landscape. I'm honored to be here among so many passionate experts from the wide range of fields who are also pushing to find better treatments for diseases like MDR-TB and Chagas and better adapted vaccines. I am reminded that when we all pool our expertise behind our vision, we really can hope to close the gap and bring affordable and effective care to the patients who need it. Today, we heard from political and medical leaders from Uzbekistan, Kenya, Brazil, India, and the US committed to tackling the challenges ahead. We heard activists from Nigeria, Kenya, and the US speaking out about the need for patients to have a seat and at the table when discussing issues that deeply affect them. And we heard from Dr. Fauci about the promising scientific advances of the past and those on the horizon. Dr. Kim is right. We are meeting at a critical time, a time when bold actions from researchers and developers, from policymakers and funders, can make sure new medicines and technology will give full benefits to the people who need them most. And I can tell you what our patients need. Number one, DRTB. The availability of better diagnostic tools is exposing what we have feared for years, a rapidly growing epidemic of drug-resistant TB. What we need is a new treatment regime for DRTB, one that is shorter and more tolerable for our patients. You have already heard my colleague Mark this morning present data from our field project, and it's truly alarming. That is why MSF is ready to work with government, companies, researchers to do what it takes to find a better regimen, one that may include the two new TB drugs in the pipeline. These are the first sign of hope for TB treatment in 50 years, and we want that to be done as quickly as possible. Number two is Chagas. 3 years ago, we started a campaign, Time to Treat, to try to scale up treatment for Chagas throughout the Americas. Only 0.2% of infected patients currently have access to treatment. But even if they could all be reached, we know the tools we have are not adequate. We need to accelerate R&D. We need a rapid test. We need safe and effective oral drugs for adults and for children. And we need a test of cure. Number three is vaccination. More than 22 million of children around the world are still unvaccinated against basic childhood killers. We want to see research priorities directed towards towards this, so it is easier for children to receive basic EPI vaccination. We need easier to use vaccine that can prevent diseases that have been all but eliminated from the developed north, such as measles and pneumonia. We need more flexible dosing schedules, so fewer medical visits are required. 5 times in 1 year might work here in New York, but when mothers might work for hours, sometimes to get to a clinic, the current system is not just practical. We heard Ambassador Dr. Ojimabo describe how the development of an oral polio vaccine to replace the injectable vaccine helped to virtually eliminate the disease. We need more improvement like this one. But there is only so much that doctors or medical humanitarian organization like MSF can do when it comes to R&D. We will continue to support the NDI and collaborate with other innovative research initiatives. We will work with governments and patients alike in our TB and Chagas program to accelerate the delivery of improved care. We will try out innovative vaccination delivery strategies and conduct operational research to scale up the latest medical innovations. And we will call for others to do their part. We have seen what can happen when the government makes a disease a priority. Look at the results of the incredible research into cancer in recent years, or into HIV/AIDS, or into malaria. But we need urgent concerted action to get suitable and affordable vaccines, treatment, and diagnostics, including for disease we have been discussing at this conference. We need a shared commitment to focus on the most pressing global health needs. This requires political will. More important, this requires a new framework for R&D that is driven by patients' needs, one based on sustainable financing with contributions from all governments, that encourages sharing knowledge, that ensures the fruits of innovation are accessible and affordable to the people who need them. 10 years ago, we diagnosed what was wrong with the R&D system. In the interim, we have been managing its symptoms. Now we want a cure. For patients like Zafar, the young boys with MDR-TB I spoke about earlier, we are struggling with a terrible treatment regimen to try and stay alive. As we work together tomorrow, let us keep patients like Zafar foremost in our minds. That way, we can be sure that our discussions are rooted in the realities of the people who have the most at stake, was the most invested in the success of our work. Thank you.